Hey, welcome to CG Hacks. I'm Dustin Volkema, and in this two-part series, we're going to be taking a look at how to create some really cool painted, scratched, grungy metal materials in Cinema 4D and Redshift using our grunge and scratch textures here from CG Hacks. I'll see you in Cinema 4D. All right, here we are in Cinema 4D and Redshift, getting ready to make a grungy material out of our basic standard Redshift material. Now, what we're going to do here first is press C. This is going to bring up our search dialog from within our node editor. And we're going to bring in a few nodes that I generally work with, and we just want to get this out of the way right now. So the first node is going to be a color node. We'll grab our color node, bring that into our node editor, grab a color layer node. There's our color layer. We can bring that in. Now, with my grunge textures, really when I'm building different texture properties, I should say, for the inputs of my materials, I like to use triplanar. So let's bring in a triplanar node. And now with the triplanar node, we are going to want to adjust the scale of our textures as we bring those in. And so we're going to use a value node here, and this is going to be a math value. And the reason why I like to do this with a value node is so I can see that there is an input there rather than just assuming that the texture is adjusted all of the time. This is more of a workflow thing when I'm working with others, and it's become a bit more of a force of habit. Now, with this being set up, let's go ahead and close out of that. And now we can bring in a couple grunge textures from our grunge pack here at CG Hacks. I'll leave a link in the description if you're interested in these. So grunge textures, the first thing that I'm looking to do is adjust the overall diffuse or color information that's being placed on the object. And what I like about the textures that we have here is that you get quite a bit of variation and breakup. Now, this first one, Grunge Kit V101, is one of my most commonly used textures when I'm doing this type of diffuse adjustment. And that's because it has a fairly even bit of contrast, and it doesn't really force me into specific shapes. Now, if I'm getting a bit more heavy and hardcore with things like a grungy patina, I might use something like this, so on and so forth. We have quite a few different types of textures here to be used with grunge and so on. So we can definitely go through this for quite a while. I think we'll save the whole salesy pitch for another day, and we'll get back to creating this material. Now, what we're going to do here is just drag our texture right into our node editor. And now we have one texture. I think we may be able to use two. And so what we'll do is we'll find one that's a bit more contrasting, maybe like this here, 07, and we can pull this in. So now what I have is I have a color value, which is going to be the base color of our diffuse input or our color input to our standard material. What I'm going to do is just make this a bit more of, there we go, a bit more of a beigey tan color. And we can use our color layer or our color node plugged into our base color of our color layer. Now we're able to start working with this in more of a layered fashion. So we'll take our color layer, we can plug this into our color one. And at this point here, we can now plug in our first grunge texture into our triplanar node, texture input. We'll do image X because we're using the same image on every axis with the way that it's projected. And we can take our triplanar node, plug that into our layer one color. And now at this point, we're going to be able to see the texture on our model. It actually looks pretty good here without adjusting the scale. I like the way that it's breaking up and it's a bit larger on the surface. So we can leave the scale of this alone for now. However, in the color layer node, we're missing the tan color that we just created with our color node. So what we'll need to do is head down to layer one in our attribute manager, and we'll have to change our blend mode from normal to something like soft light. Soft light and overlay are our most common blending modes that I'll use here, pretty much like Photoshop. They really work in the same way. Now we have our grunge texture, or the second one here, and this is going to be used to add a little bit of darkening or maybe visual dirt in the crevices of this painted material. So what we're going to do is take our float node, or our value node that we created, and we can, let me back up a minute. We'll go ahead and press Control or Command, click and drag our triplanar node down, and we can release our mouse button. That's going to duplicate it for us. And now we can take our grunge texture, our second one here, into inputs, texture, and then image X. And now we'll grab our float node, or our value math node, and plug this into our triplanar under coordinates, and then scale. This is going to allow us to adjust the scale. Now we're not quite done. So we want to have a different color, a bit more of a grungy looking color in the crevices or the concave aspects of this material. So we can use a curvature node for this. So let's search for that. We'll grab a curvature node, drop this into our node editor. Again, to bring up this dialog box, I'm pressing C inside the node editor. Now we can take our triplanar node, plug this into our curvature and release. We can head to general and then radius. Now at this point, we still need to have a color for this mask that we're building currently to be plugged into. And what we can do is actually plug in our curvature node into our mask, or our color layer two. So we have layer two mask. I realized I was zoomed out a bit far, so I'll zoom in to show you that. Now, at this point, we have to enable our layer two of our color layer node. So we'll head back into the attributes of the color layer node, down to layer two, click on enable, and now we're going to be able to see that we have quite a bit of darkening or dirt in certain areas. But this is all of the concave faces or the corners of our model, and we want that reversed. So let's click on the curvature node here, and we're going to change our mode from convex down to concave, and this is going to give us dirt in those concave spots. We'll grab our float node, which is currently set to zero. That's zero by default, so we don't currently have anything visible here because our texture is at a scale of zero. Now, we can change that quite easily. We'll just go ahead and press maybe like a 0.5 for the scale. And we can see this a little bit better if we maybe head to the curvature node and click our solo icon here. Now in the render view, I'll speed up this process a little bit. We'll press the render region. There we go. And we can scale this just a bit right down to our wing here. There it is. And now the radius is really breaking up the what would normally be a smooth curvature or a smooth set of lines here in these concave crevices. Now, I'm quite happy with the way that this is looking right now. And if I wanted to adjust this, there is definitely a way to do that. And the way that I would do this is by adjusting the texture first. So placing something like a ramp node in between our triplanar node and the curvature. Let's search for a ramp node. We can drag this and drop that right into the noodle in between our two nodes here. There we go. And now at this point, we can start to drag our black points a little bit further. And this is going to really crunch down some of those details that we have here. Now, you may be wondering why I'm not using something like a linear workflow or using my color information from my texture node as raw directly from the gate. And that's primarily because I will do that when I need to do that. There are times where I like to crunch the RGB values and not have so much range in a texture. And in this case, this is working out quite well for us. Now, let's go ahead and unsolo our curvature node and see what this is looking like. So we can see that we have bits of dirt here in the cracks and crevices. And we have a really nice overall adjustment to the base layer color or the color layer, the diffuse that we're building up right now. Now, for the first texture, this is an area where I definitely might want to go in and set our grunge kit texture one that we have here to a color space of raw. Let's see if we can bring that over. Looks like it's quite long here for the file name. Anyways, we'll head to our color space from auto. We'll go down to file IO and then raw, and we'll see the difference that this makes. It gives us a lot more of a dynamic range here in the texture, and there are definitely times where we may want to change this. In this case, I think we do need to crunch this down a bit further. So what we're going to do is after our triplanar node, we're going to bring in a ramp node, and we can drag our ramp node into the noodle here for our layer one color. And we will just start to tone down or crunch down these blacks a little ways. There we go. And we can push this a little bit further by grabbing our gradient handle there. I feel like that's getting to a point where I might like it. Now, if I want to change the interpolation, I know that we're covering quite a bit, but I feel that maybe this stuff is worth it. If you didn't know this before, there's certain things here that you might pick up. So let's go ahead and right click right outside of our gradient. We'll head to the interpolation of all knots here. And there are really two ways that I will go about this. Most often, I like to use the cubic bias. I really like the effect that we have that it gives here. And this is going to allow us to adjust and crunch a little bit further. Maybe we'll tone that down. Bring our white up just a little ways. Okay. And now that looks pretty good. I just want to adjust the opacity of the adjust or of the layer that we're currently affecting. So I'm going to take the mask from layer one with selecting our color layer node, and I'm going to bring that down to something like maybe halfway. And we'll start there at 0.5-ish. Give that a moment to resolve. And then we can bring this up a little bit further. Let's try something like 0.75. And this is giving us a good input. So I like the way that this looks here. If we zoom out, we can see that we have some nice grungy crevices to this. Those are currently just black because in our color layer node, if we head down to layer two, our color is black. Let's change that. We can maybe head to something like a dirt color. A little bit grungier here. There we go, something along those lines. So that gives us a little bit of color to mess with. And we can bring up our value here a little ways so it's not completely black with the Asus transform that's currently on it. Now, from this point, I'm not going to really focus on adding bump to this material right away. But what we will want to do is adjust our roughness. So I'm going to create a little bit of space here between our diffuse stack or our color stack here from the color layer. Create a little bit of separation. I'm going to clean this up by clicking our small hamburger icon here on the top of the node. And we click once. What that's going to do is just show us all of the inputs that we have rather than everything else that's connected. So that's still going to be visible. And we can now press Control or Command and we can click on the noodle of this color layer that's between the out color and the input for our base color. And this little noodle is going to allow us to plug this texture in to many other nodes while keeping things fairly organized. So now we can bring our handle down to the reflection roughness and use this same color layer for the reflection roughness that we're going to be adjusting. Now, at this point, what we will probably want to do is grab a ramp node. So let's go ahead and do that. We'll grab our ramp node and plug this in right in between our knot from the color layer and the roughness input that we created. And we're going to solo our roughness. Now, knowing that black, when it's being plugged into roughness, black is going to be shinier and white is going to be a bit more diffused reflections, we might just want to invert the way that this is working so that all of these little crevices and the dirt that we placed in here is going to be a lot less shiny and give us a bit more of a realistic result there. So what we can do with the ramp selected is right click and simply invert gradient. Now with this being done, we may want to crush our black points here a bit so that we can bring up some of the detail and it's not all completely diffuse. But something like that, and then we can unsolo our ramp node. There we go. And now we have a really good base to start building some added wear and tear and extra grunge to this that we'll handle in part two. Grunge textures, they're pretty cool, right? Now, if you're used to Photoshop, this is going to be very familiar in the kind of workflow that we're using and layering and building different textures on top of one another. It's really how I like to think of 3D as a whole, especially when I'm dealing with shading and lighting. As a photographer, I kind of transfer a lot of those lighting techniques and knowledge that I have there when it comes to lighting and in materials. My Photoshop skill sets come into play and I like to adjust different materials, blend them together, so on and so forth. So in part two, we're going to be talking about how to add scratches to this material that we just created and start to build this up into a bit more of a complex material while still remaining quite simple. So I'll see you in part two. If you're interested in the CG Hacks grunge textures, check out the link in the description. I'll see you in the next video.